Okay, the next type of enthalpy, standard enthalpy of neutralization. So it is the enthalpy change when one equivalent of acid reacts with one equivalent of base under standard conditions. One equivalent of acid will react with one equivalent of base to form one mole of water. So what is this equivalent? So now, number of equivalents is equal to number of moles multiplied by NF, where NF is called N factor. For example, if I talk about HCl, HCl splits in this manner if I dissolve HCl in water. So HCl is hydrochloric acid. Since I get 1H plus on dissolving 1 unit of HCl, I say that the N factor of HCl is 1. So N factor of acid is the number of H plus ions produced. So if I talk about HCl, the N factor will be equal to 1. Similarly, if I talk about H2SO4, then it splits in this manner. So the N factor of H2SO4 is 2 because I have 2H plus. So this is how we define the N factor of an acid. If I talk about HCOOH, this splits in this manner. So again, the N factor is equal to 1 because I have 1H plus. If we talk about CH3COOH, this is how it splits. So again, I have 1H plus, so N factor of CH3COOH is 1. So N factor is with respect to the number of H plus ions produced for an acid. If I talk about this acid, oxalic acid, H2C2O4 is called oxalic acid. It splits like this. This is called oxalic acid, H2C2O4. So again, I can clearly figure out that the N factor is 2. So, in order to find out GEQ, you need to know NF, because GEQ is equal to number of moles into NF. So GEQ is equal to number of moles into NF. So we should know what is the N factor of a particular acid. Similarly, we can also find out N factor of base. NaOH is a base. It splits like this. I get one OH minus from one unit of NaOH. So N factor of NaOH is 1. If I split barium hydroxide, this is what I'll obtain. So N factor of barium hydroxide is 2. Because I get 2 OH minus. So for a base, I can find out N factor in this way. That is how many OH minus ions are produced. And for an acid, how many H plus ions are produced. So GEQ is called gram equivalence. This is a full form. Also, we can say just equivalent. If I just say equivalent, like here I have said, this also means GEQ. So GEQ means equivalent. How do I calculate it? I calculate it by using this formula. Number of gram equivalents is equal to number of moles into NF, where NF is called the N factor. For an acid, N factor is the number of H plus ions produced. For a base, N factor is the number of OH minus ions produced. MEQ is called milli equivalence. So 1 gram equivalent is equal to 1000 milli equivalents. Fine. Okay. Now let's see the values. So what is standard enthalpy of neutralization? It is the change in enthalpy taking place when one equivalent of acid reacts with one equivalent of base under standard conditions. Now, for a reaction between a strong acid and a strong base, the value of enthalpy of neutralization, that is delta H neutralization, is equal to minus 57.3 kilojoule. It's a fixed value which we have to remember. So when there is a reaction between a strong acid and a strong base, then the enthalpy change is minus 57.3 kilojoule per mole of water formed. Means if 1 mole of water is formed, then the enthalpy change is minus 57.3 kilojoule. This minus 57.3 kilojoule is also same as minus 13.7 kilocalories. One kilocalorie is equal to 4.18 kilojoules. Also, we may say that delta H neutralization is equal to minus 57.3 kilojoule or minus 13.7 kilocalorie if 1 gram equivalent of a strong acid reacts with 1 gram equivalent of a strong base. So if 1 gram equivalent of a strong acid reacts with 1 gram equivalent of a strong base, then the enthalpy change will be minus 57.3 kilojoule or minus 13.7 kilocalorie. So it is defined in two ways. Either you say that the value is minus 57.3 kilojoule per mole of water formed, that means if 1 mole of water is formed in a neutralization reaction, then the enthalpy change is minus 57.3 kilojoule. Or we can say that if 1 gram equivalent of a strong acid reacts with 1 gram equivalent of a strong base, then the value of enthalpy change of neutralization is minus 57.3 kilojoule. Now, if the neutralization reaction is between a weak acid and a strong base, or between a strong acid and a weak base, that means if one component is weak, then the value of energy released is less than 57.3 kilojoule per mole of water formed. So now 57.3 kilojoule will not be released if 1 mole of water is formed. Why? Because one of the acids, one of the components is weak. Either the acid could be weak or the base could be weak. So what is the difference between second point and first point? In the first point, both acid as well as base are strong. So if both acid as well as base are strong, then we can say that the value of enthalpy change is minus 57.3 kilojoule per mole of water formed. But if one of the components is weak, either the acid could be weak or the base could be weak, then the value of energy released is less than 57.3 kilojoule per mole of water formed. And if both acid as well as base are weak, acid as well as base, if both are weak, then also the value of energy released is less than 57.3 kilojoule per mole of water. Now, why is the value of energy released less than 57.3 kilojoule per mole of water formed if one of the components is weak? So this happens because some energy is utilized in ionizing the weak component. Means what? If something is weak, let's say the acid is weak, this is the weak acid, then to ionize this into H plus and A minus, some energy is consumed in this process. Since some energy is consumed in this process, the value of energy released will be less than expected. So if a weak component is present, some energy is used up in splitting or ionizing the weak component. But if there's a strong component, for splitting a strong component, no energy is consumed. For splitting a strong component into its ions, no energy is required. But if it's a weak component, then some energy is utilized in ionizing the weak component. So as a result, the energy released will be less than expected. So in general, this is a formula for finding out enthalpy of neutralization in kilocalorie. So this is a formula which you have to know for finding out enthalpy of neutralization in any reaction involving acid and base. Minus 13.7 multiplied by gram equivalents of acid or base reacted. So either you can take the acid or you can take the base. So minus 13.7 multiplied by GQ of acid or base reacted plus delta H dissociation into moles of weak reactant reacted. What is this delta H dissociation? As I said, some energy is consumed in ionizing the weak component. So that is this enthalpy of dissociation. Some energy is consumed in ionizing the weak component. So that is this enthalpy of dissociation, delta H dissociation. So for any strong acid or strong base, as I said, delta H dissociation is equal to zero. So there is no energy required to ionize a strong acid or a strong base. So delta H dissociation is equal to zero for all strong acids and strong bases. In general, I can represent a neutralization reaction in this way. H plus plus OH minus forming H2O. And for this particular reaction, delta H is equal to minus 13.7 kilocalorie or minus 57.3 kilojoule. So let's do a question. The enthalpy of neutralization of oxalic acid by a strong base is given as -25.4 kilocalorie per mole. Find out the enthalpy of dissociation of oxalic acid. Okay, now if they're asking us to find out the enthalpy of dissociation of something, that means by default that thing component is going to be a weak component. Why? Because for a strong component, the enthalpy of dissociation is zero. So if they're asking us to find out the value of enthalpy of dissociation of something, that by default means that the component is a weak acid or a weak base. So they have asked us to find out the enthalpy of dissociation of oxalic acid. That means oxalic acid is going to be a weak acid. That is why they're asking us to find out the enthalpy of dissociation of oxalic acid. So we have come to this conclusion that oxalic acid is going to be a weak acid because they are asking us to find out the enthalpy of dissociation of the acid. This is the formula of oxalic acid. We don't know how many moles of oxalic acid have been taken because the question has not mentioned the number of moles of oxalic acid. So let us assume that there are X moles of oxalic acid that have been neutralized by a strong base. So if I say that there are X moles of oxalic acid, that means that's an assumption that there are X moles of oxalic acid that have been neutralized. So let us assume that there are X moles of oxalic acid. Now, we can go back to this particular formula, that is enthalpy of neutralization in kilocalories can be found out using this particular expression. Let us put the values in this equation one by one. So first we need GEQ of acid. So oxalic acid is the acid here. So GEQ of oxalic acid. Now the formula for GEQ I have given you today. GEQ is equal to moles into NF. Moles of oxalic acid is equal to X. This is the assumption that we have made. So GEQ will be equal to 2X because NF of oxalic acid is equal to 2. Why 2? Because H2C2O4 is the formula of oxalic acid. If I put H2C2O4 in water, it will split like this. H2C2O4 splits as 2H plus C2O4 2 minus. This 2H plus tells us that the N factor of oxalic acid is going to be 2. So g q of oxalic acid is 2x. Okay. Enthalpy of neutralization of oxalic acid is given as minus 25.4 kilocalorie per mole. Now look carefully. Here it is given that the enthalpy of neutralization is minus 25.4 kilocalorie per mole. That means for 1 mole of oxalic acid, this is going to be the value of enthalpy of neutralization. So for 1 mole, per mole means 1 mole. For 1 mole of oxalic acid, this is going to be the enthalpy of neutralization. But we have taken x moles of oxalic acid. So the enthalpy of neutralization is going to be minus 25.4x. For 1 mole, if the value is minus 25.4, therefore for x moles, the value is going to be minus 25.4 multiplied by x. So minus 25.4 into x kilocalories is the value of enthalpy of neutralization. Now we can use the formula of enthalpy of neutralization. Delta H neutralization is equal to this. In kilocalorie, minus 13.7 into GEQ of oxalic acid plus delta H dissociation into moles of oxalic acid reacted. So let's put the values now. So delta H neutralization is how much? Minus 25.4x. So this is what I can put. Minus 25.4x is equal to minus 13.7 multiplied by GEQ of oxalic acid. What is the value of GEQ of oxalic acid? 2x. So here I'll put 2x. Plus delta H dissociation multiplied by moles of oxalic acid. So delta H dissociation into X. What is X? Moles of oxalic acid is X. So here, delta H dissociation is unknown. That is what we have been asked to find out. X will get cancelled out throughout. So from here, I'll get the value of delta H dissociation as 2 kilocalorie per mole. Everything was in kilocalories, so the ultimate answer will also be in kilocalories. Next question. This is the reaction given to us. half N2 gas plus O2 gas giving NO2 gas. Calculate delta H at 400 Kelvin. If delta H at 300 Kelvin is minus 35 kilojoule. CP values are given. So there are two different temperatures. One is 400 Kelvin and the other one is 300 Kelvin. So calculate delta H at 400 Kelvin. If delta H at 300 Kelvin is given. So if there are two different temperatures and two different values of delta H corresponding to the two temperatures, then we use Kirchhoff's equation, which is this. This equation was discussed in the previous lecture. So now let us solve a question based on this. So what is Kirchhoff's equation? Kirchhoff's equation will tell us the dependence of delta H on temperature. So if there are two different temperatures and two different values of delta H, then we will use Kirchhoff's equation. So T1 is temperature in Kelvin, T2 is also the temperature in Kelvin. So at T1 Kelvin, the value of enthalpy change is delta H1. At T2 Kelvin, the value of delta H is delta H2. And what is delta CP? Delta CP is calculated in this way. Summation of CP of products minus summation of CP of reactants. So let's put the values. So this is the reaction given to us. Half N2 plus O2 giving NO2. CP values of the species are given. So let us find out delta CP now. So this is delta CP. What is delta CP? Summation of CP values of products minus summation of CP values of reactants. In this reaction, my product is NO2. So CP of NO2 multiplied by 1. What is this 1? 1 is the coefficient of the species in the reaction. So every CP needs to be multiplied by the respective coefficient of the species present in the reaction. So 1 into CP of NO2 minus half into CP of N2, half is the coefficient of N2, so half into CP of N2 plus 1 into CP of O2, because the coefficient of O2 is 1. So this is how we will calculate the value of delta CP. So these are given CP values, we can put the values. So 1 into Cp of NO2, it is 35. Minus half into Cp of N2, that is half into 30. And then plus 1 into Cp of O2. Cp of O2 is given as again 30. So I'm putting the values here. I'll get delta Cp. So this is the value of delta Cp. Now let's put the values in Kirchhoff's equation. Delta H2 is the value of enthalpy at temperature T2. Delta H1 is the value of enthalpy change at temperature T1. T1 is 300 Kelvin, T2 is 400 Kelvin. Any one temperature can be taken as T1, so the other will become T2. The value of delta H at 300 Kelvin is already given as minus 35 kilojoules. So I can put that. So at 300 Kelvin, the value of delta H is minus 35 kilojoules. Minus 35 kilojoules is nothing but minus 35,000 joules. I've converted it to joules. On solving this, we'll get the value of delta H2. Again, that will be in joules. And I can convert that joules to again kilojoules by dividing by 1000. This was also in joules, delta Cp. Why? Because in the question they have used Cp in joules. So everything has to be done in joules. Okay, next type of enthalpy is bond enthalpy. Bond enthalpy is represented as BE. Short form of bond enthalpy is BE. So this is a theoretical part. Let me explain to you what it means. Let us understand the example first. If CH4 is taken, CH4 is taken in the gaseous form, then one by one, let us break CH bonds present in CH4. So in CH4, if I break the first CH bond, so this is CH4. If I break the first CH bond, let's say I'm breaking this particular bond, then I will get what? CH3 plus H. The rule is, when you are breaking the bond, you should break the bond in such a way so that you get atoms after breaking. So if I break this bond, I will get this hydrogen atom, which is this hydrogen atom. So it is atom, it is a gaseous atom. So CH3 and H atom will be obtained. The value of enthalpy change occurring in this process has been called delta H1. So what is delta H1? Delta H1 is the enthalpy change for this particular step, that is step 1. So what is this step? In this step, I have broken the CH bond in such a manner that I have obtained one hydrogen atom after breaking it. Similarly, now which I have obtained is CH3. So the species now obtained after breaking one CH bond is CH3. I can again break one CH bond present in CH3. So if I break one CH bond in CH3, again one hydrogen atom will come out and I'll be left with CH2. So that will be step 2. So, likewise, in each step, I can break one CH bond. In each step, I can break one CH bond. So, in this way, there will be 4 steps. There will be 4 steps. So if I ask what is the value of bond energy or BE of CH bond, then that bond energy or BE of a CH bond is going to be the average of all these different delta H values corresponding to the four steps. Means what? In step one, I have broken the first CH bond. I have supplied some energy, which is delta H1. Again, in second step, I break another CH bond. I supply again some energy. That will be delta H2. Again, in the third step, I break the other CH bond. Again, I'll have to supply some energy. That will be delta H3. And again, in the fourth step, I will break the last CH bond. That will be delta H4. So the bond energy or BE of a CH bond is going to be the average of these four delta H values. Means what? Delta H1 plus delta H2 plus delta H3 plus delta H4 upon 4 is going to be the average value. This average value will be called the bond enthalpy of CH bond. So, if I show you the steps, this is step one. This is going to be step two. This is going to be step three. And this is going to be step four. In every step, I have broken one CH bond. So in every step, energy has been supplied to break CH bond. The average of these four delta H values is going to be called the BE or bond energy of CH bond. So BE of CH bond is delta H1 plus delta H2 plus delta H3 plus delta H4 upon 4. Because that's how you calculate the average. So BE or bond enthalpy of CH bond is going to be the average of the bond dissociation enthalpies of the four steps. Delta H1, delta H2, delta H3, and delta H4 are called bond dissociation energies or BDE. Ek ek step mein jo energy supply ki ja rahi hai bond ko todne ke liye, that is called BDE, bond dissociation energy. Or average of all the bond dissociation energies is called BE, that is bond enthalpy. So remember that the B values are positive because bonds are broken. And if bonds are broken, energy needs to be supplied. That is why the value of B is always positive, because energy is being supplied. Whenever energy is supplied, that means the value of delta H is positive. Another point to be kept in mind is that whenever we are breaking bonds, we are going to obtain gaseous atoms. So if you look at the components after the arrow in each and every step, all are gaseous. All are gaseous. So when you are breaking a bond, you will obtain gaseous atoms. That is the definition of bond dissociation. So in every step, we are obtaining gaseous species. Now let's come to a reaction. If I have a reaction of this kind where A, B, C, and D are present and all are gaseous, then I can use this formula to find out delta HR, where delta HR is called change in enthalpy of the reaction. So how do I calculate the change in enthalpy of this reaction? I can calculate the change in enthalpy of a reaction using the bond energies. This is a formula to be used if I want to find out the value of enthalpy change of any reaction from the data given for bond enthalpies. So delta HR is equal to summation of bond energies of all types of bonds and reactants minus summation of bond energies of all types of bonds and products. So it is reactants minus products. All types of bonds present in species need to be looked at. So I have to take some of the bond energies of all types of bonds. That is why this sigma symbol has been used. Another point to be kept in mind is this. If any monoatomic species is present in solid state, then its enthalpy of sublimation needs to be considered. Means what? In this reaction, if a particular monoatomic solid component is present, like carbon solid or anything of that kind, which is solid, then first I need to take its enthalpy of sublimation. That means I have to first ensure that all the species are present in their gaseous form. All should be in gaseous state. Then only I can use this formula, which you see here. That is summation of bond energies of bonds in reactants minus summation of bond energies of bonds in products. So if a species is present in solid state, that has to be first converted to a gas by taking enthalpy of sublimation. That is what is mentioned here. If any monoatomic species is present in solid state, then its enthalpy of sublimation needs to be considered. So let's take a sum. This is a question. Standard enthalpy of formation of ammonia is given to us. Bond dissociation enthalpy of hydrogen gas is given. Bond dissociation enthalpy of nitrogen gas is also given. And now we have been asked to calculate the bond enthalpy of NH bond. NH, that means nitrogen-hydrogen bond. Now NH bond is present in which species? NH bond is present in NH3, that is ammonia. So that means in this question, bond enthalpies have to be used because data is given in terms of bond enthalpies. Also, we have been asked to calculate the value of bond enthalpy of NH bond, and this indicates that we have to use the formula in terms of bond enthalpies. So what is the reaction that we need to consider? That will be given in the reaction, in the question. The question has mentioned formation of NH3. Formation of NH3 means the reaction should be for the formation of NH3. Now formation means that particular compound should be present on the RHS, that is right hand side of the arrow. And that too, only one mole of the component should be present on the right hand side. Because last time we discussed that whenever they are asking about formation, by default it means that one mole of the species should be present on the right hand side of the arrow. So if ammonia is being formed, ammonia should be present on the right hand side of the arrow and one mole of NH3 should be present. So this is the reaction that we will look at. This is the reaction. So in this reaction, ammonia is being formed. Why? Because NH3 is present on the RHS, that is right hand side of the arrow, and also one mole of NH3 is present on the right hand side. On the left hand side, the components or the elements from which ammonia is formed are written. The elements are N2 and H2. And last time we discussed the standard states of elements. Nitrogen is N2, hydrogen is H2. The standard state of N2 is gas, the standard state of H2 is also gas. Reaction has to be balanced. But while balancing, we have to keep in mind that we cannot change the coefficient of NH3 because NH3 is being formed, and whatever is being formed must be present with coefficient equal to 1. So 1 has to be the coefficient of that species which is being formed. So in this case, NH3 is being formed. So the coefficient of NH3 has to be 1. So I cannot disturb the coefficient of NH3 to balance the equation. I can only disturb the coefficients of other species which are present on the left-hand side of the reaction, which are N2 and H2 respectively. So the coefficient of N2 is 1 by 2, the coefficient of H2 is 3 upon 2, and this has been done because we wanted to balance the reaction. If you don't balance the reaction, you cannot go ahead with any sum. So we have to balance every chemical reaction. let's use the formula now for bond enthalpies. Okay, for this particular reaction, now we can use this formula, that is delta HR is equal to summation of bond energies of reactants minus summation of bond energies of products. Which are the reactants in this reaction? N2 and H2 are the reactants in this reaction. So what is the bond enthalpy of N2? It is given as 712 kilojoule per mole. And the bond enthalpy of hydrogen is given as 436 kilojoule per mole. So this is the formula. Delta HR is equal to half into 712. Half is the coefficient of N2 here. So the bond energy of N2 has to be multiplied by half. 3 upon 2 is the coefficient of H2. So the bond enthalpy of H2 has to be multiplied by 3 upon 2. Every bond enthalpy must be multiplied by the coefficient of the species in the reaction. So this is what we have done. Minus bond enthalpies of product. What is the product? NH3 is the product. Now NH3 has three NH bonds because this is the structure of NH3. So if I say bond enthalpy of NH3, it is nothing but 3 multiplied by bond enthalpy of NH bonds. Because in NH3 there are 3 NH bonds. So bond enthalpy of NH3 is nothing but 3 times the bond enthalpy of NH bond. Bond enthalpy of NH bond is not given in the question. We have been asked to calculate that. So that is the unknown parameter. Now delta HR is given to you in the question. For the reaction it is given. Standard enthalpy of formation of NH3 is minus 46 kilojoule per mole. So minus 46 is the value of delta HR. So we can put delta HR as minus 46. So from here, we can calculate the value of bond energy of NH bond on solving this equation further.
Done, sir.
So we have got the value of bond enthalpy of NH bond. Next question. Find out the enthalpy of formation of isoprene gas, gaseous form, that means they want. And what is isoprene? They have given us the structure of isoprene already in the question. Since the value, since the structure of isoprene is given to us in the question, it is easier for us to find out, I mean, judge what types of bonds are there in isoprene, because they have given us the structure. So this is the structure of isoprene. Also, they have given us data of bond enthalpies. Bond energies are in kilocalorie per mole. So these all are given. Note down the values. This entire piece of information is very important, because we will be solving the question based on the data given. So write down the values. This is the structure of isoprene. So the bond enthalpies are given to us. Whenever bond enthalpies are given in the question, we can immediately use the formula for delta HR in terms of bond enthalpies. Okay. They want us to find out heat of formation of isoprene. Again, I repeat, whenever the word formation is used, that means we are supposed to write that particular species whose formation has to be done on the right hand side of the arrow, and also the coefficient of that species must be. So isoprene should be present on the right hand side of the arrow, and the coefficient of isoprene must be 1, because isoprene is being formed. So this is going to be the equation for formation of isoprene. So isoprene is being formed, that is why it is mentioned on the RHS of the arrow. Coefficient of isoprene is 1. on the left hand side of the arrow, I have mentioned the elements present in isoprene. So elements are carbon and hydrogen. And we have to use standard states. That is why carbon is in solid state and hydrogen is in gaseous state. Standard states have to be used. Reaction has been balanced. So this is going to be the equation representing formation of isoprene. Now we can use delta HR. So this is the reaction which is for formation of isoprene, and we need to calculate delta HR for this. Okay, so delta HR is equal to summation of bond enthalpies of all bonds in reactants minus summation of bonds of all enthalpies in products. So let us look at each component and then understand which bond enthalpies have been used. First reactant is carbon. Carbon is the first reactant, but then carbon is in solid state. Carbon is in solid state. Now I have given you one thing earlier. Here we mentioned if any monoatomic species is present in solid state, then its enthalpy of sublimation needs to be considered first. If any monoatomic species is present in solid state, then its enthalpy of sublimation needs to be considered. So at the moment we have carbon here in this reaction, which is monoatomic in the solid state. So we have to take enthalpy of sublimation of carbon first, which is given to us in the question, 171.7 kilocalorie per mole. So here, 5 into 171.7, why 5? Because coefficient of carbon is 5. So 5 into 171.7 plus 4, which is the second reactant, hydrogen. So for that I'm writing now, coefficient of hydrogen is 4. So 4 multiplied by bond enthalpy of hydrogen. So 4 into 104. So first we consider the reactants, the bond enthalpies of all the species in the reactants. So hydrogen and carbon are the reactants here. But carbon is in solid state. That is why we have to take enthalpy of sublimation of carbon. So 5 into 171.7. But 171.7 is the sublimation of carbon. Plus 4 into 104. 104 is the bond enthalpy of hydrogen, which is given to us in the question if you look here. HH bond. HH bond is the bond existing between two hydrogen atoms. The bond enthalpy of HH bond is 104 kilocalorie per mole. So 104 is the bond enthalpy of hydrogen. So this is what we have taken, 4 into 104. So done with the reactants, minus. Now the bond enthalpies of the bonds in product. Product is isoprene. And let us see which all types of bonds are present in isoprene. So now if you look carefully, how many CH bonds are there? So if you count the number of CH bonds, then you will see that there are 8 CH bonds. CH bond means bond between C and H. So there are 8 CH bonds in this isoprene, if you count, looking at the structure. So 8 CH bonds are present in isoprene. So 8 multiplied by bond enthalpy of CH bond, which is 98.8 kilocalorie per mole. So 8 into 98.8. So here I have to write 8 into 98.8 plus 2 into 147. 147 is the bond enthalpy of C double bond C. So how many C double bond C here? So we have 2 C double bond C bonds. So there are 2 such CC bonds. There are 2 CC bonds. CC means C double bond C. So here I have written 2 into 147. Plus 2 into 83.1. 83.1 is for CC single bond. So if we look here, you will see that the bond enthalpy of CC single bond is 83.1 kilocalorie per mole. There are 2 CC single bonds in isoprene. So 2 into 83.1. On solving this, I'll get the value of delta HR. So this is the value, 23.9 kilocalorie.